Welcome back, everyone. Today we learn about leaf structure and photosynthesis. First, let's explore the structures and cells that are found in a leaf in greater detail. This is the transverse section of the leaf, and under light microscope these are the various structures one can observe. The first structure we will look at is the upper cuticle. It is thick, waxy, waterproof and transparent. It serves as a barrier against water and gas loss and allows sunlight to penetrate through the lower layers. The second structure is the upper epidermis. It is thin, made up of single layer of closely packed cells. However, these cells don't contain chloroplasts. These cells protect the inner layer of cells in the leaf and allows light to reach the mesophyll cells, the palisade mesophyll. Are made up of cells that are closely packed and cylindrical in shape. These cells contain plenty of chloroplasts. The large concentration of chlorophyll situated at upper layer help to absorb maximum sunlight for photosynthesis. The close packing help keep as few cell walls as possible between sunlight and chloroplast. The spongy mesophyll, on the other hand, contains cells that are loosely arranged with large intercellular airspaces. The cells contain fewer chloroplasts than the palisade mesophyll cells. The intercellular airspace found in this layer allows for diffusion of gases such as water vapor, carbon dioxide, and oxygen to occur. Since these cells contain chloroplasts, they are able to carry out photosynthesis to absorb any sunlight that escaped the palisade layer. Next, we have the vascular bundle. It contains the xylem and phloem. The xylem transports water and mineral salts from the roots to all other parts of the plant. The phloem transports food made by the leaves to other parts of the plant. We will study this in greater detail in the subsequent video. The lower epidermis consists of a layer of epidermal cells. It also contains stoma, which is guarded by two guard cells. While the lower epidermal cells don't contain chloroplast, the guard cells do contain chloroplast. The lower epidermis protects the inner layer of the cells in the leaf. The stomata found in this layer help control exchange of carbon dioxide, water, and the loss of water. The presence of chloroplast in the guard cells aids in the opening and closing of the stomata. Lastly, the lower cuticle, which is thinner than the upper cuticle, is waxy, waterproof, and transparent. It serves as a barrier against water and gas loss. Now, let's look at photosynthesis. The equation for photosynthesis is as shown, whereby in the presence of light and chlorophyll, carbon dioxide and water is converted to glucose and oxygen. Chlorophyll, as we recall, is the main site of photosynthesis. That is because it is able to trap light energy and convert it into chemical energy for the formation of carbohydrates and their subsequent use. Chlorophyll is only found in plants. Now, why most forms of life are completely dependent on photosynthesis? For survival purposes, living organisms need energy that is obtained from breaking down energy-rich food. The origin of organic molecules in food come from green plants, as they can carry out photosynthesis. Thus, living organisms get energy directly or indirectly from the photosynthesis of plants. For example, by consuming vegetables directly or by consuming a chicken that once consumed corns for survival. Now that we know how photosynthesis works, we shall now study how does the plant obtain the raw materials needed for photosynthesis and what happens once the products of photosynthesis are made. First, we will look at how plants take in carbon dioxide. Earlier we looked at how the structure of the leaf, and we know that the opening and closing of the stomata regulates the diffusion of gases in and out of the leaf. So what determines if the stomata opens and closes? Well, during photosynthesis it provides energy in the form of ATP, which drives potassium ions into the guard cells, and other ions are taken in as well to balance the charges. This causes an increase in solute concentration in the guard cells, which lowers their water potential. Thus water enters the guard cells via osmosis. When water enters the guard cells become turgid and expands by bowing apart, creating a hole between them. Thus in daylight, when photosynthesis occurs, The turgid guard cells cause the stomata to open so that carbon dioxide can enter the leaf for photosynthesis to occur and allow the stomata to remain open. Once carbon dioxide enters the leaf through diffusion through stomata into the intercellular airspaces, the carbon dioxide dissolves into a thin film of moisture layer found on mesophyll cells. The dissolved carbon dioxide then diffuses from cell to cell until it reaches the chloroplasts of mesophyll cells. Second, we will look at how plants take in water. The root hair cells will absorb water from the soil via osmosis. Water travels from cell to cell via osmosis and from cell wall via diffusion until it reaches the xylem. Water is then transported up the xylem by transpiration pull, capillary action, and root pressure. Water then moves into the mesophyll cells and leaves in response to an osmotic gradient. We know that at the end of photosynthesis, glucose and oxygen are produced, but what happens to these products afterwards? For glucose, it is broken down during respiration to produce energy or ATP for vital activities. It can be used in the synthesis of cell wall. Or it can be converted into amino acids, proteins, and even fats. Excess glucose is converted into sucrose for translocation or stored as starch in chloroplast. Or stored as starch in the form of starch granules in the cytoplasm of storage organs like tubers in plants. For oxygen, it is produced and released during photosynthesis. And the rate of photosynthesis is usually measured by the rate of oxygen production, as it is easily measured. Lastly, we will end of this video by looking at the important minerals for plants. Nitrate ions are absorbed through the root hairs by diffusion and active transport, and combines with glucose to produce amino acids that are used to make proteins. Magnesium ions are soluble in water and are absorbed through root hairs by diffusion and active transport, used to make chlorophyll. That's all for today. Thank you for the effort to learn with me. Stay tuned for more interesting lessons. See you next time. Bye-bye.